when the trials you face turn into darkest night, and you're hoping in some way the darkness will turn to light, and you feel all alone and no one is there with you, never fear, my God is holding you. He is there to comfort you when you feel your world is shifting. He is there to hold you when everything is changing. My Lord's still there. Some days I was so lost, I just couldn't see him. There were moments I felt my heart would just give in. But when you are through with trying and there's nothing left to do, never fear, my God is holding you. He is there to comfort you when you feel your world is shifting. He is there to hold you when everything is changing. My Lord's still there. My Lord's still there.
All right, maybe at the end we might take some questions. We'll allow you to do that at the end. But I do want you to take your Bible, and I want you to go to two portions of Scripture tonight. And your preacher said to make sure you're out of here by 10:15, okay? And I will honor that, I promise you. Matter of fact, I'll even do better than that. I'll get you out before 10:15. How about that? Now, I want you to take, I want to look at two portions of Scripture. Go to the book of Jonah and hold your place in the book of Jonah. And then go over to Romans chapter number 10. So I want you to hold your place there in the book of Jonah, and we'll refer back to that in just a little bit. But I want you to go over to Romans chapter number 10 this evening. Romans chapter number 10. Romans chapter number 10, very familiar verses of Scripture. And if you don't mind, would you please stand as we reverence the reading of God's Word this evening? Romans chapter number 10, Romans chapter 10. And I want you to look down at verse number 13, Romans chapter 10, verse 13. And the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." I like that verse. What a refreshing promise that is. As a 19-year-old, even though I had grown up in church, the Lord began to deal with me about salvation. And I had absolutely nothing to offer God but a life that was headed to hell. The Bible says our righteousness are as filthy rags. I had nothing to offer God. But I came to Him on His terms, recognizing who I was, a sinner destined for hell. And I recognized who Jesus was, that He and He only is the Savior. The Holy Spirit of God drew me, and I called upon the name of the Lord, and I got saved as a 19-year-old. I liked that verse. By the way, let me tell you something about your preacher. He and I were in a youth meeting, years ago. And he preached on a Wednesday night, and my wife and I are trying to figure out what he preached, and we don't know what he preached on that Wednesday night. But he preached that Wednesday night, and as soon as the service was over, my wife and I got in our car, and we headed to St. Louis to watch the St. Louis Cardinal baseball team the next day. I don't know if you're Kansas City fans, but I got my St. Louis Cardinal socks on tonight. And as I got closer to Kansas City, man, there's just something, you know, came over me. And so I had to go to the hotel a while ago and put my St. Louis Cardinal socks on. I had to have these on. So anyway, so my wife and I, we leave Wednesday night after he got through preaching. We went up to St. Louis to watch the game the next day. Well, we get up there about midnight and get in a hotel. And the next morning, about 4:30 in the morning, my wife is up. I knew something was wrong. I mean, 4:30 in the morning, my wife is up. And I said, what's the problem? She said, I've got to get this thing straightened out. The Lord's wearing me out. And she was under conviction. She got saved that morning. Amen? Yeah. Your preacher had preached the night before, and the Lord used him in that message. And my wife, who had grown up in church, and she was married to a preacher at that time, she got saved. Amen? God's good, isn't he? Really is. Anyway, I like this verse. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Notice verse 14. How then shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of being here tonight. And thank you, Lord, for the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And I pray that you'll help us now. I pray that the Spirit of God would do a work among us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let me just quickly give you three very generic statements that I think we could all agree with. And here it is. Number one, here's the first statement I want to say. I believe it is every Christian's responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus. Amen. I mean, I think if you've been saved by the grace of God and His righteousness has been imputed to your account, you're justified in the sight of God. And matter of fact, when I was flying into Guam last January with my daughter, Michaela, we flew over the Mariana Trench. That's the deepest part of the ocean. You can take Mount Everest and put down there and you still got about 8,000 feet of water before you ever come to the surface. That's a deep part of the ocean, the Mariana Trench. And as we were flying there, I got to thinking about that verse of Scripture that says our sins are buried in the depths of the sea. Amen? Amen. And I'm flying over the Mariana Trench thinking, man, my sins are about 7 miles down there. Praise the Lord. Now look, if you're saved, your sins have been forgiven, you've been justified in the sight of God, you got a friend that's sticking closer than the brother. Brother, if you're a Christian, you have a responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus. Amen. And it's not a suggestion in the Bible. It is a command. That's what we're supposed to do. So, statement number one, I believe it's every Christian's responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus. Now, here's the second statement. We've got to hurry. Second statement is this. I believe it's every church's responsibility to get people saved, baptized, and taught in the Lord. Amen? Amen. I believe it's every church's responsibility to get people saved, to get them baptized, and to get them taught in the Scripture. That's why we are in existence. Amen? And every once in a while, we just kind of need to be reminded of why we're here, and that is to get people saved and baptized and taught. That is a church's responsibility. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. I know it applies to us personally, but also it applies to a local New Testament body, a local church. So it's every church's responsibility to get people saved, baptized, and taught. Now, here's the third statement. I'm going to put them together. I believe it's every Christian's responsibility, yay, I believe it's every church's responsibility to be involved in missions, both locally and internationally. Because, I mean, it's Acts chapter 1, verse 8. I believe it's every Christian's responsibility, I believe it's every church's responsibility to be involved in missions, both locally and internationally. By locally, here's what I mean. It is our responsibility, or this church's responsibility, to reach Marshall. Amen? That's where we are, right? We're in Marshall, right? Very good. The other day, I said that to someone, and I was in the wrong city and wrong state. But the point is this. It is your responsibility to reach this town. I'm a member of Bethel Baptist Church in Walls, Mississippi. It is our responsibility to reach Walls, Mississippi. But now listen, it's also your responsibility to get the gospel to the entire world. Just like Bethel Baptist Church in Walls, Mississippi, it's their responsibility, or our responsibility, to make sure that the gospel is given to the entire world. We are to be involved in missions both locally and internationally. And I think we can all agree to that tonight. Amen? Okay, so those are three quick statements about missions. I want you to keep that in the background. And now I want you to go to the book of Jonah. Okay, let's go to the book of Jonah. In the Old Testament, this book of Jonah, one of my favorite books in the Bible, the book of Jonah. Now, I can kind of relate to the book of Jonah because I was the one guy that joined the military because no one was going to tell me what to do. You know, you're not going to tell me what to do. I'm going to join the military. Yeah, we're going to tell you when to get up, go to bed, what to eat, what to wear, and all those things. You know how they are. In fact, you become, I'll never forget, I went to the MEP station in Memphis, Tennessee, and I raised my right hand, and it was a Marine major that swore me in. And I was joining the Air Force, but it was a Marine that did that. And I'll never forget, after he did that, he said, "You're now a piece of government property. You'll go where we tell you to go. You'll do what we tell you to do because you're now owned by the U.S. government." I thought, okay, all right, just tell me what to do. But the point is this. You're going to find I can relate to the book of Jonah because Jonah ran from God, and I kind of did that a little bit for a little while until God got my attention. Amen? So the book of Jonah is one of my favorite books in the Bible. In fact, let me point out a couple things about Jonah before we get to the heart of the message. If you ever read after, and I don't suggest you do this, but if you ever read after theologians or scholars, you got to be very careful, by the way. But if you ever read after so-called theologians and scholars, you're going to find most of them, they will attack three parts of the Old Testament. They attack Genesis chapters 1 and 2 because it deals with creation. Amen? A lot of liberal scholars don't believe in literal creation. And so they attack Genesis chapters 1 and 2. They also attack the story of Noah and the flood. And then they attack this book right here, the book of Jonah. And all these liberal scholars and theologians, they like to attack those three areas of the Old Testament. But here's what I find so interesting about the New Testament. In the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when Jesus himself walked upon the face of this earth, Matthew chapter 12, Matthew chapter 19, and other scriptures, you'll find that Jesus himself, he addressed those three areas. He addressed the story of creation, he addressed the story of Noah and the flood, and he also addressed the story of Jonah. And Jesus himself put his validation on those three areas. And by the way, if Jesus put his validation and endorsement on it, that's good enough for me. Amen? I don't care what a liberal theologian or a liberal scholar says. Jesus himself said, those are three valid areas, and I'm going to believe it. Amen? In fact, this is God's book. I'm going to believe it from cover to cover because as a child of God, that's what we're supposed to do. Amen? And so they like to attack the book of Jonah. Now, as a Baptist preacher tonight, I've kind of got a problem with the book of Jonah. You're going to say, oh, Brother Barnes, where are you going with this? Well, let me say this. My problem does not involve God because he never changes. Amen? He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, and you can trust him. Praise the Lord for that. So when it comes to the book of Jonah, my problem does not involve God. In fact, preacher, I find that there, in some Baptist churches, there's this idea of Calvinism kind of seeping in. And basically these Calvinists claim that God has willed this person to be saved and this person will never be saved and nothing can change the will of God. Well, you know, the book of Jonah addresses that. In Jonah chapter 3, the Bible says Jonah preached and God changed his mind. Okay. How about that, Mr. Calvinist? In fact, the Calvinists really like to really build up this one word called the elect. That this, you know, select group of people are God's chosen and that's it. By the way, in the book of Jonah, God's elect were the children of Israel. And I find in Jonah chapter 3 that God stepped outside of the elect and he extended his grace to the heathen people. Amen? God extended his grace to the people of Nineveh because he came into his own and his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. God's grace is for anyone, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen? Amen. So my problem does not involve God in the book of Jonah. By the way, in the book of Jonah, my problem does not involve the people of Nineveh who are pagan people. In fact, the book of Psalms, Psalm 2, asks this question. Why doth the heathen rage? I found the answer one day when I was studying. Here's why the heathen rages. Because they're heathen. Yeah. Amen. Why doth the heathen rage? Because they're heathen. Why do the pagan people act like pagans? Because they're pagan. Yeah. You see, in the book of Jonah, the people of Nineveh were acting like pagans because that's what they were. Right. So my problem does not involve, by the way, my problem is not with my neighbor down the street acting like a lost person. They act like lost people because they're lost. Yes. Right. So my problem in the book of Jonah does not involve God. It does not involve the people of Nineveh. By the way, in the book of Jonah, my problem does not involve the message that Jonah preached. In Jonah chapter 3, he preached an 8-word message and the whole city got saved. That's pretty powerful, amen? Hey. I mean, he preached 8 words and the whole city got saved. Unbelievable. You know what my message is? The death, the burial, and the resurrection. And it's still a powerful message. It is so powerful that a lost person can change their destination. It is so powerful that a marriage can be brought back together. It is so powerful that a home can be brought back together. It is so powerful it can change a home, it can change a life, it can change a marriage, it can change a country, it can change a church. That's a powerful message. You say, well, preacher, what's your problem with the book of Jonah? My problem is with a man by the name of Jonah, who's a backslidden missionary. That's the problem I've got in the book of Jonah. Yeah. You see, God called Jonah to go to a heathen group of people, and Jonah said, no way, I'm going the other direction. And he was a backslidden missionary. That's the problem that I have in the book of Jonah. Now look at your Bible there. Would you look at Jonah chapter number 1? We'll get to the message here in just a minute. This is just preliminary, okay? Usually the preliminaries last about 20 minutes and the message lasts about 5, okay? So y'all just hang on. Jonah chapter 1 verse 1, notice what the Bible says. The Bible says, now the word of the Lord came unto Jonah the son of Amittai saying, notice the call of God on Jonah's life. God speaks to him. Do you know that God still speaks tonight? And God may be speaking to someone in this room about becoming a missionary. I love it when God speaks. Now, sometimes He speaks and it's not a pleasant message, but I'm going to tell you, it's still refreshing to know that He speaks to me. So I find the call of God on Jonah's life. Look at Jonah chapter 1, verse 2. The Bible says, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city. Notice the commission that's placed on Jonah's life. You see, the commission involves an assigned duty, a specific duty. And if you're a child of God tonight, God has an assigned duty for you. God has a specific task for you to do. So I see the commission. Now look at verse number 3. The Bible says in verse 3 of chapter 1, but Jonah rose up to flee into Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa. Verse number 3, I find the cost of running from the presence of God. And you're going to find that he goes down to Joppa. Then he goes down to the harbor, he goes down to the ship, he goes down into the sides of the ship, he goes down into the water, he goes down into the whale's belly, eventually he goes down to the bottom of the earth. There's only one direction that a person can go when they run from the presence of God. It's a downward spiral. And so I find the cost, and there's many things we could say about that tonight, but that really has nothing to do with the message tonight. So I want you to look at Jonah chapter 1, verse number 17 in the few minutes that we have. Jonah chapter 1, verse number 17. Notice what the Bible says in verse 17. The Bible says, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, there are many people that will say, well, was it a fish or was it a whale? If God wants to call a whale a fish and a fish a whale, that's God's business. Matter of fact, if this Bible said that Jonah himself swallowed the whale, I'd believe it because the Bible says it. Amen? Because that'd pretty well settle it. But I want to focus on this verse for just a few minutes. A lot of times I have to move around. Let me tell you, two reasons why I move around. Number one, I get nervous in front of people. And number two, I think better if I move. If I move, it'll be a faster sermon. I said that one time and a guy said, run, run, preacher, run. I want to look at verse number 17. Notice this fish. This is what I'm going to focus on for a few minutes. Keep in mind the three statements I said. It's every Christian's responsibility to tell somebody about Jesus. It's every church's responsibility to get people saved and baptized and taught. And it's every church's responsibility, every Christian's responsibility to be involved in missions both locally and internationally. Amen?
Amen.
Now, look at verse 17. Notice the fish. And here's the question that I'm going to ask. This is an intelligent group right here. And here's my question tonight. Are you smarter than a fish? You going to answer that? This one said yes. This is like guys like, nah, he's setting me up. Are you smarter than a fish tonight? You say, what do you mean? I want to give you 5 characteristics of this fish tonight. And let's just see if we're smarter than a fish in relation to missions. Let's look at this fish. Because this is a focal point in this book, this fish is. Let me give you 5 characteristics of this fish, and you ask yourself this question, am I smarter than a fish tonight? Number one, here it is, you ready? Look at chapter verse 17 again. The Bible says, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Here's the first thing about this fish. Number one, this fish was prepared to do the work that God designed for it to do. You say, oh, Brother Barnes, that's not really deep. That's bottom shelf stuff. That's the way I preach, bottom shelf. Because that's the kind I can grab, okay? Now notice this fish. He said it was prepared. This fish was prepared to do the work that God had designed for it to do. This fish was prepared. That's what the Bible says. Verse 17, notice. Now the Lord had prepared. This fish was prepared to do the work that God had designed for it to do. Look at chapter 4, would you? Look at chapter 4, verse number 6. The Bible says in verse 6 of chapter 4, and the Lord God, notice, prepared a gourd. There's that word again. Here's this gourd. It's a piece of vegetation. It has broad leaves on it. And Jonah, during the heat of the day, he would get under those leaves and it would provide for him shade. Notice this gourd was prepared by God. Look at verse number 7. The Bible says in 4:7. The Bible says, but God prepared a worm. Here's the word again, prepared. Notice this worm is prepared by God. It's going to bite the gourd, kill the gourd. Look at verse number 8. The Bible says in verse 8, and it came to pass when the sun did arise, here it is, that God, notice, prepared a vehement east wind. Notice, the wind is prepared by God. Here's what's amazing in this book. In chapter 1, verse 17, a fish was prepared by God. In chapter 4, verse 6, a gourd was prepared by God. In chapter 4, verse 7, a worm was prepared by God. In chapter 4, verse 8, the wind was prepared by God. Here's another thing amazing. In chapter 1, verse 17, the fish listened to God. In chapter 4, verse 6, the gourd listened to God. In chapter 4, verse 7, the worm listened to God. In chapter 4, verse 8, the wind listened to God. Here's what's also amazing to me. In 2017, the animal life will respond to God. The worm will respond to God. The vegetation will respond to God. And the weather will respond to God. Here's something else that's amazing from this book and from 2017. The fish, the animal life listens to God. The vegetation listens to God. The weather listens to God. The only one that doesn't listen to God is the one that God died for, Jonah. It's amazing tonight in 2017, the animal life will respond to God. Vegetation will respond to God. The wind will respond to God. But we, as God's people, the ones that God died for, we don't respond to God. Here's a question. Are you smarter than a fish tonight? This fish was prepared to do the work that God had designed for it to do. It was prepared by God and it followed that plan. Are you prepared? When you pulled in the parking lot tonight and you pulled in that parking place, before you got out of the car, did you say, God, prepare me for the sermon tonight? God, prepare me for the music tonight? God, prepare me for the invitation tonight. Prepare me for the presentation tonight. Are you prepared? Are you smarter than a fish tonight? All right, let's move right on. We got to hurry because it's almost 10:15. Look at number 2 there. Here's the second thing. I want you to look at chapter number 2, would you? Chapter 2, look at verse number 1. The Bible says, then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction. Here's the second thing about this fish. All right, number 1, this fish was prepared to do the work that God had designed for it to do. Number 2, from chapter 2, verse 1. Number 2, here's the second thing about the fish. This fish convinced Jonah that it was time to start praying. Amen? Look at chapter 2. Don't take my word for it. Look what the Bible says. Then Jonah prayed unto the Lord his God out of the fish's belly. And verse 2, and said, I cried by reason of mine affliction. Notice Jonah's ready to pray now. This fish convince Jonah that it's time to start praying. Here's a question. What kind of fish will it take to get you to pray? What kind of fish is it going to take to get me to pray? Because you see, when the money's right, when the health is good, and when the relationships are strong, you know what happens to our prayer life? It goes straight down. And it usually takes a fish to get us on our knees. And this fish convinced Jonah that it was time to start praying. Look at chapter 2, verse 1. Notice what it said. He said, I cried. Notice it is a passionate prayer. You know what our prayer closets need? They need some passion. Hey. The Bible says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And we need to go to our prayer closets and we need to cry unto God with a little bit of passion. Look at verse number 5. Notice what the Bible says down there at verse number 5.
The Bible says, the waters compassed me about, even to the soul. The depths closed me round about. The weeds were wrapped about my head. Now, can you understand that? I mean, here's Jonah praying. Here's what he said. Man, I'm down here and the weeds are wrapped about my head. This is what I call plain speaking prayer. Amen? There's passion in his prayer and there's plain speech. And we need some plain speech in our prayer life. I'm amazed, preacher. Sometimes you'll go to a prayer service and somebody gets up to pray and I'm thinking, brother, what do those words mean? I've never heard that before in my life. Who are you trying to impress? You know what impresses God? Plain speaking. In fact, last night I saw a good friend of mine. His name's Kevin Hardwick. He's got cancer, and he's made it a year, but he's right there at the end. Brother Kevin, my wife and I had an adult Sunday school class for 15 years, and several years ago, Kevin was a bouncer in a bar, and he got saved. Man, I was so glad to see Kevin get saved. His wife was saved. His family got saved. Brother Kevin became the best soul winner in our church. Won more people to the Lord, brought more people to church. Anyway, I'll never forget when Kevin got saved, just rough old fella. After a few weeks, he became one of the ushers. And so he'd come down on Sunday morning. I remember our preacher went over to him one Sunday morning and said, hey, Kevin, he said, do you mind getting behind the pulpit and praying? And Kevin's like, no way, I'm not getting up there. Are you kidding? I'm in church now, God save me, but I'm not getting up behind that pulpit and praying. Preacher said, okay, don't worry about it. A few weeks later, preacher went to him again. He said, hey, you ready to pray? He goes, nope, not yet, can't do it. Well, a few weeks later, preacher went to him and said, you ready to pray? And he said, I'm going to try it. I was sitting up on the stage. I remember old Kevin, old tough guy, he came up there and, boy, he got behind the pulpit and he was shaking. I mean, it was just, it's humorous to me. I mean, he's shaking, this big old guy. I mean, he lived his life fighting and doing all these things. So here's Kevin, he's shaking, he's scared to death. He starts praying, he just fumbles over the words. But can I tell you, the Lord moved in that prayer. You know why? Plain speech. And look down at verse number 9. Notice, I will sacrifice in the Lord with a voice of thanksgiving. Here's a third thing you need in your prayer closet. You need passion, plain speech, and you need praise. You get those three things in your prayer closet, you'll get a hold of God. Amen? Amen. This fish convinced Jonah that it's time to start praying. Let me ask you a question. Are you smarter than a fish tonight? Let me give you a third one. Look down at verse number 2 of chapter 2. You're looking at me like, this guy's crazy. He's talking about a fish tonight. Look at chapter 2, verse 2. The Bible says, and he said, I cried by reason of mine affliction to the Lord, and he heard me. Notice, out of the belly of hell cried I, and thou heardest my voice. Here's the third thing about this fish. Don't miss this. This fish gave Jonah a glimpse of hell. Now notice what the Bible says. He said in verse number 1 that he cried by reason. Notice, he was praying. Verse number 2, I cried by reason of mine affliction, and he heard me. Out of the belly of hell cried I. This fish gave Jonah a glimpse of hell. And let me just remind you what took place after Jonah caught a glimpse of hell. He started praying and he became submissive to the Lord. Right. You know what we need tonight? I'm talking about all of us, God's people, saved children of God. You know what we need to understand tonight? That hell is a real place. Right. And we need to understand that there is real fire in hell. We need to understand that there's real torment in hell. We need to understand that it's forever. That the rich man that died and went to hell in the book of Luke, that in 2017, there is still a cry for mercy coming out of his mouth even today. There is still a cry of misery coming out of his mouth even to this day. That there is still a cry of memory as he realizes every opportunity that he had that he did not take advantage of. And there's even a cry for a missionary from his lips today that says, go tell my family about this place. Hell is a real place. And if we as God's people understood the fact that hell is a real place and that people who die without Christ go to hell, it would change our prayer life and it would change our submission. Amen? This fish gave Jonah a glimpse of hell and it changed his life. Let me ask us a question tonight. Are we smarter than a fish tonight? Well, let me give you a fourth one. Would you look down at Jonah chapter 2, look down at verse number 9. The Bible says, but I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. Preacher, let me ask you this. I don't know how you do your missions. Do y'all do a faith promise? Yes, sir.
Okay? Do people ever write down an amount? Do people write down an amount on their faith promise? Yes. About what they want? Okay. Here's the fourth thing this fish did. This fish got Jonah to vow a vow. That's what the Bible says in that verse there. Now, do you know that when you write down a figure for missions, that you're vowing a vow to God?
Right.
Now, every once in a while, you'll meet certain Christians that say, Brother Barnes, I don't get into vows and commitments. Are you married? Got a car note? Got a mortgage? You see, our problem is not commitment. Our problem is submission to God.
Right.
I'm talking about all of us. We struggle with that. But I want to remind us tonight that when we come down to an altar and we say, God, I'm never going to do this again, if we go out there and do it, we're breaking a vow. When we come down to an altar and we say, God, I'm going to do this, and if we don't fulfill it, guess what? We're breaking a vow. And God wants us to fulfill our vows.
Sure.
Vows are not a bad thing. You're going to find that this fish got Jonah to vow a vow. Let me ask you a question. Are you smarter than a fish tonight? Now look at verse number 10. Let me give you the fifth one. This is the last one, by the way. Look at verse number 10. Notice what the Bible says. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited out Jonah upon the dry land. Now, this is the word of God right here. Look what it says. And the Lord spake unto the fish, and it vomited. Vomited. That's what the Bible says. Amen? I believe the King James Bible is the word of God. That's what it says right there. It vomited Jonah upon the dry land. Notice upon the dry land. This is significant to me. Because I was thinking one day, how did this fish perform this duty? It vomited Jonah out. Now, either this fish got off the shore a little ways and it vomited him out at such a high speed that he landed like an albatross. It probably would kill him, right? But notice what the Bible says upon the dry land. Think about it this way. What if this fish beached itself so that Jonah could go out upon dry land? A fish of this size, if it were to beach itself, literally, it would die, its organs would be crushed from its own weight. What if this fish sacrificed itself so that Jonah the missionary could get to the place where he could deliver the gospel message? What if this fish sacrificed itself upon dry land so that Jonah, the missionary, could get to the people of Nineveh, so the people of Nineveh could get the gospel message and be saved? Here's the fifth thing about this fish. This fish got Jonah, the missionary, to the place where he could deliver the gospel message.
Yeah.
This fish became the tool in the hands of God that got Jonah the missionary to the place where it could deliver the gospel message. This fish became the vehicle used by God to get Jonah the missionary to the place where he could deliver the message so the whole city could be saved. This fish in the hands of God became the tool, the implement that God used to get the missionary to a foreign field. Let me ask us tonight, are we smarter than a fish? Isn't it our responsibility to be involved in missions both locally and internationally? Isn't it our responsibility to be a fish, to get the missionary to the place? I'm a member of Bethel Baptist Church, and even though I'm going overseas, that is the church where my membership is. That's where my giving goes to. That's where my missions goes to, my tithes and offerings, so that people can be sent all over the world, so that the gospel message can be given. I am to be a tool. You are to be a tool. Are we smarter than a fish tonight? I know it's a simple thought, but this fish was prepared to do the work that God had designed for it to do. This fish convinced Jonah that it was time to start praying. This fish got Jonah to vow a vow. This fish gave Jonah a glimpse of hell. And this fish got Jonah to the place where he could deliver the gospel message. Are we smarter than a fish tonight? Here's what I'm afraid of, preacher. I'm afraid that most of us, when it comes to missions and when it comes to delivering the gospel message, and when it comes to these type of things, we see the need, but very seldom do we fulfill the need. Many times we are guilty of seeing the problems that are out there. We see the need that is out there, but very seldom do we satisfy that problem. Very seldom do we fulfill that need. I was reminded several months ago of a story. A fellow by the name of Kevin Carter. Kevin Carter was from South Africa. In fact, in the 1980s, Kevin Carter joined the South African military. He didn't like military life, so he went AWOL. Well, they caught him and they made him fulfill his commitment. But after fulfilling his commitment, Kevin Carter decided that he wanted to do something to help humanity. He wanted to make a difference. Kevin Carter became a photojournalist from South Africa. He would go to various parts of the world and take pictures so that the world could see the problems that persisted. Well, in 1993, Kevin Carter found out that there was a problem in South Sudan. Civil war, the atrocities of that civil war, famine, desperation. So he took his camera and his crew and he went to South Sudan to take pictures so that the world could see the devastation. One day, one of the UN trucks came in and it was delivering food. And he noticed a little child crawling across the sand. The child was bloated, malnutrition. And the child seemingly was taking its last breath. So Kevin Carter knelt with his camera, focused on the child. And when he did so, he noticed behind the child, about 10 yards, was a vulture perched on a rock. That vulture was looking at that child as if to wait, as if waiting for that child to take its last breath. He took the shot, took off running to another part of the war-torn area. March the 26th, 1993, the New York Times ran that picture in its Sunday paper. I've got a copy of that picture. Immediately, that picture became a sensation. People all over the United States began to call the New York Times. People all over the world began to call. And here was their question. What happened to the child? Did the photographer help the child? Did the photographer feed the child? Did the child survive? Did the child live? What happened to the child? 9 months later, that picture won a Pulitzer Prize of photojournalism. 9 months later. It's a very famous picture of a child with a vulture behind it. 3 months after it won the Pulitzer Prize, Kevin Carter, the photographer, committed suicide and took his own life. He was haunted by the fact that people were calling regarding the child, and he was plagued by the fact that he himself never lifted a finger to help the child. And I'm afraid that many of us, when it comes to getting people saved, giving the gospel, not only locally, but internationally, we're just like Kevin Carter. We take a picture of the need, but we don't help satisfy the need. Let me just tell us all, when we do what Kevin Carter did, we become Christians most miserable. Amen?
Sure.
You see, I don't want to just take a picture of the need. I don't want to just see the video that says, boy, we need to take the gospel to all the parts of the world. I want to satisfy the need. I want to help fulfill the need. I want to help take care of the need. And so tonight, I ask us this question. Are we smarter than a fish when it comes to missions? Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm going to turn the invitation over to the preacher. But it's just a simple thought tonight. Are we smarter than a fish? There is a lost and dying world that needs Jesus. And it is our responsibility to take the gospel to them. Will you be involved? Will you help satisfy the need? Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll bless the invitation time. Thank you for the word of God which liveth and abideth forever. In Jesus' name we pray.